Oh, there it is. All right. Well, welcome everyone. Thank you so much for showing up this evening. And I think to get started, let's all just drop in with one another. If you have any sage or Palo Santo, you could burn that. I already just burned a little bit of sage right here, but take a straight spine. Place our feet on the ground. Take a big inhale with one another. Exhale, sigh it out. Allowing each of these breaths to bring us into this present moment together. Take another big inhale. Exhale, sigh it out. Just want to share my gratitude to each and every one of you for showing up this evening with your heart and your presence and your energy, for hearing this call to gather with other people with shared values around living in harmony and balance with the earth, with ourselves, with one another, living with reverence in right relation, being good stewards of this planet, and feeling into the more healthy and beautiful and thriving and regenerative communities that we have the ability to co-create together. For hearing this call to live a life more connected to nature, to community, to spirit. Showing up here together with open hearts, with open minds to share inspiration and wisdom with one another, to support one another in this journey towards creating healthy, thriving, beautiful communities. Spirit, thank you all for being here. So I will start and share just a little bit of context to a little bit of my background and what has inspired the gathering of the tribes. My background is in architecture and moved here to San Diego, started working in an architecture firm, and in 2012 started a nonprofit organization called Local Earth, focused on regenerative community development, and have been involved with all kinds of projects and initiatives around sustainability for the last probably 12 years. We had a prototype eco-village project outside of San Diego from 2018 to 2020 in Valley Center. A small a group of 11 of us came together to live on 12 acres of land for 2 years. Our nonprofit had a partnership with the landowner, and we all did a training in sociocracy as our organizational model and our governance model. Because one of the core values that's important to me is distributed power and authority. So there's not like any one chief or CEO or, person that's leading it, where really the team and the community is co-creating the process. And I find that sociocracy or holacracy is a good model to do that. So we explored that for 2 years. It was a beautiful experience and came out of that. It was interesting timing, came right into the beginning of the pandemic, and had those several interesting years, and just in this last year have come out just being like, okay, I'm ready to get back onto land with people with shared values and want to live in a more intentional and connected way. And so I just started like thinking, I'm like, okay, like how do I reach out and find people that have these, similar core values? And that was just kind of what started the concept for this gathering of the tribes. And so the format that we currently have is once a month online tonight, and the first, typically the Thursday of the month, but I have a solar convention tomorrow, so it's Wednesday this month. And this online group is for people all across the country. We have people even in different countries that are sharing a similar vision. And then once a month in person, we come together. And the idea is wherever any of you are at, that you could have your own gathering of the tribes in your own town or community. Like I'm in San Diego. So I've been hosting here on the third Saturday of the month, the last couple of months, a in-person gathering. And it's really beautiful. This last week we had it at this place called the Living Joy Homestead. It's a 1 acre property here in East County, San Diego, with just an amazing permaculture demonstration site, so much food growing. And we had almost 80 people show up and had a potluck and had small breakout rooms and or groups, and it was a really beautiful experience. So we'll be doing that here in San Diego, every third Saturday of the month. And there's a template on our website that if any of you want to have your own, gathering of the tribes, just a real simple template, get together, have a potluck, have some intentional discussion, that you're all welcome to host one of those in your own town or community. And then on the third Thursday of the month, we have the Regenerative Community Development Mastermind, which is a deeper dive into people who really want to like focus on building community, getting onto land. And we take a deeper dive into like zoning and building permits and just the real nitty-gritty of like what it would take for a group to come together and build an eco-village or an intentional community. And then we have kind of a exciting special gathering of the tribes coming up in October down in Baja on October 20th through the 22nd. We're going to do a 3-day gathering of the tribes down at a property called Lumeria. And a friend of mine owns 15 acres down there. It's right on the ocean. It has a private beach on the Sea of Cortez. And there's already four-bedroom, four-bathroom houses built on the property, with another third community building with a big community kitchen and a studio upstairs. It's all powered by solar and has a desalination plant on the property, so it's totally off-grid. And 3 acres, there's currently being a yoga retreat designed. There's a two-story yoga shala being designed and built right now. And so 3 acres is going to be a yoga retreat. And the other 12 acres is very open to some form of intentional community or small eco-village. So October 20th through the 22nd, we're going to do a 3-day gathering of the tribes down there for people that want to learn more about the Baja Lumeria project. And then we're going to have a 7-day community incubator after that. So people who want to stay down there longer and experience kind of a co-living, co-working experience with other people, we'll have 7 days afterwards for that. And so I'll put that in the chat if anybody is interested. There's a website link. So that's kind of a special gathering of the tribes that we've got coming up, and that's not part of our normal pattern. And yeah, so I think let's get into a little. Well, actually, there's a small group, so I think we could just do it. I was going to put us in breakout rooms, but let's do like a short introduction of ourselves and your name, where you're zooming in from, where you live, and what is inspiring you to participate in Gathering the Tribes, what's inspiring you to be here tonight. And let's try to keep, I'll set the timer on my phone for a minute, and let's try to keep it about a minute each. And if you keep going, I'll just show a little reminder here. You're at about a minute. You don't need to stop right then, but just, we'll try to stick with about a minute each. And let me get my timer started. Let's see. John Paul, would you like to start us off? Think think you're muted there, brother. Maybe not start.
Yeah, you're muted. There you go.
Hey, sir.
There you go.
Good to see you, Josh. It's
Good
been a
to see you.
minute. Sorry I didn't get to see you when you came through here. In Taos, I heard you got to meet my daughter,
I did.
my wife. My wife's back here.
Hello.
Yeah, I live here in Taos, New Mexico, and recently my wife and I just stayed 10 days in the Llama Foundation. I'm not sure if many of you know what the Llama Foundation is. But totally incredible space, like community meals. They have a music room, a library. They have this gigantic meditation dome that's a geodome, like at the top, and is the highest elevation point in Taos. Really cool place. And I have a community project in Carson, New Mexico. There's six of us at about 8 acres. And community. But yeah, I have a lot of stuff going on, and but y'all should come visit us in the Llama Foundation. You can do seva. So if you're looking for a meditation retreat, you know, just kind of going inside yourself, they do a 30-minute meditation at 7:30 every day. And you know, if you're looking into like wanting to be a part of a community, I think that one's been around since the 60s, so it's a really good place to learn from. Because they've, you know, made the mistakes already that we're trying to avoid. But yeah, great to be here. Thanks for having me, Josh.
Awesome. Thanks for being here, brother. Yeah, and I'll before we go on to the next introduction, I'll just kind of expand on what John Paul just said here. Part of this is just networking with one another because this is the online. I mean, it could be all across the country and just sharing different communities and projects that people might want to be part of. Like, you know, there's stuff that's already existing. Some of us might, you know, cultivate relationships and friendships through here that are like, hey, maybe we want to actually move on to land and start that together. So there's a big spectrum of kind of what the intention of we're trying to serve with these gatherings and meeting one another. So thank you, John Paul. Let's go to, is it Jean?
Hi, Jeannie. Thanks.
Hello, Jeannie.
Hi, everyone. I'm in Cleveland, Ohio. I'm heading on Friday. I'm taking Amtrak across the country and heading to Watsonville, California, to Mount Madonna Center. It's a yoga and retreat center over there, and I'm going to be volunteering for 3 months, which will be my first real experience living in an intentional community. So I'm super excited about that. Even though I don't think it's what I'm looking for, but I'm going for it. I was really bummed when I found out about Lumeria because that sounds like really what I'm looking for. I'm committed to the 3 months at Mount Madonna, but I'm going to see if there's any way that I could possibly get down there. I don't really want to fly for 3 days, so I'm just gonna, you know, put my intention out there and see what happens.
Awesome.
Because the beach is where I want to be. Yoga, I mean, Mount Madonna is yoga. But yeah, I've had this desire to live in community for many years, and I put it, you know, gave it top priority in 2023, and so. You know, I'm taking a big step on Friday, and I'm excited about that. And if anybody else knows of a yoga retreat center, I'm finishing my yoga teacher training in a couple months, and on the beach somewhere. That's me. That's where I'm going to be.
Awesome,
Yeah.
Jeannie.
Yeah.
Thanks so much for being here. It's an exciting adventure you're taking off on Friday.
Yeah. Thank you.
Let's see. Let's go to, is it Jacques?
Hello, everyone. Can you hear me well?
Yes.
Great. Yeah, that's Jack. Thank you so much for having me here. Thank you, Joshua, for all that you do, and really appreciate that. So, to make it concise, I live on so I live close to Albuquerque in the East Mountains, in the up in the mountains. And I started to envisioning community living when I divorced my ex-wife, and that's 7 years ago. And so I started to start putting this together here. And then about three and a half years ago, we started to have actually a community, and we have put a lot together. We have a couple of yurts. We have a sweat lodge. We do sweat lodge monthly. We have a couple of trailers. We have a main adobe house, and then a casita as a living space. And we have chickens and, you know, sheds and carport and, I mean, wood shop and stuff. But we have had recently a problem with zoning. And kind of that really has shaked everything to the ground and has made some people leave, and that made me decide that some things that I want to change. So what I'm trying to do is to find a core people to have a, I put it in the description of the questions, to buy a piece of land that is bigger, because 5 acres, we cannot do very much. I have a couple of places that I'm thinking of right now, and buy it as a land trust. So I don't also, as you mentioned before, I'm not excited about being the top of everything and being responsible of everything. It's become too much. I want to work with people more equally. So I learned about land trust. So that's what I'm trying to do. I would like to find the right people to create that core member, to buy that some lot as a land trust, and then possibly a private membership association. I don't know too much about those stuff, but I heard a lot of good things. And if I can find that, then I could move both yurts, I could move both trailers, I could move a whole solar system, then a significant solar system, and some other things. So I will have some things to bring in. I by selling this place, I think I can, you know, have a certain amount of money to be able to obviously contribute in buying that. So that's my intention right here, right now.
Beautiful.
Where are you located?
We are 30 minutes southeast of Albuquerque in the mountains.
Yeah, so you and John Paul are not that far from each other.
Right. That's right.
And is it Jack or Jacques?
Jacques.
Jacques, okay. Well, thank you.
I know where. Sorry.
Oh,
I know where some land is, like 1,000, 2,000 an acre out here, and you know, I know some spots for land out in town.
Yeah, you two should definitely connect, and I'd love to be part of that discussion as well, because I'm very interested in New Mexico and Colorado for sure.
I have interviewed two lots. One is 150 acres. It's only like 15 minutes from here, and it's full forest. It's beautiful. There's a house, there's solar, and there's some things on it. And another one at the Earthship with 53 acres, which is also beautiful. So those two are in mind. $1,000 sounds like so much, but I think we need to have some structure on it to make it a bit easier to start off with.
Yes. And there's a 144 acre property in Taos that I met a guy on our trip in June that they're purchasing as well. So I should follow up with him and see. It's a beautiful spot. It's got a bunch of pine trees on it. And so I'll follow up on that as well.
I'm just going to say that for me, the advantage of being not too close from a city like Albuquerque is I do healing work with people and other kind of work. And it's really helping to be able to, you know, to have access to that amount of people. And in the meantime, being really secluded.
Yeah.
And I have a son who, you know, I share with my ex-wife 10 minutes from here. So I'm more hoping to find something closer. And Tijeras is where I am. It's actually a really beautiful place.
Okay.
Very nature there.
Awesome. Well, thank you so much for being here, brother.
Mm-hmm.
All right, Carrie.
Hi, thank you. So I'm Carrie Lake. I live in Encinitas,
California, and Joshua and I met years ago at Boris Mikhtov's house when there was just a really casual gathering. What inspired me to be here is I just love being among people who are nice to each other, and it's kind of that simple. And I know Joshua is a very kind person, so whatever he's creating, I just thought this will be a group of nice people. I've never thought specifically about being part of an intentional community. However, my heart kind of feels like I would love to have my own place in and among others, right? Which I think is kind of the idea. And with people being nice to each other, you know, bonus. that really is the simplicity of it. The work I do stems from my lifelong communion with the animal kingdom. I help people understand not only communicating with their animals, but knowing their own ability to do that and how that branches out into the world. And I'll just share that my most recent project I'm completely stoked about. It's called Redefining Intelligence. And it literally proposes just that, to redefine intelligence from this linear approach of humans create a problem and solve it. And if you can solve it, that means you're intelligent and you get a number, to a matrix where any species, any ecosystem, any individual, the way intelligence functions through them gets illuminated, and that can create a matrix that will help people perhaps recognize how ecosystems communicate with each other, how banana slugs are actually freaking brilliant, and instead comparing everything to the human linear approach. So I actually got to present that to University of Saskatchewan, their Department of Environment and Sustainability, did a symposium on intuitive interspecies communication. And that's not just like, you know, does my dog love me stuff. It's about actually deeply listening to the land, to the weather, to the plants, to all of life. So it's really, really exciting where all that's going. So anyway, and that was more than a minute, but I'm grateful to be here. And thank you all for sharing your brilliance.
Very great to see you here. Nice to reconnect after many years.
Yeah, thank you.
Jamie.
Hi, my name is Jamie. I live in Southern Humboldt County, California. And from about 13 years old, I grew up in and then eventually co-owned intentional communities for many years. And after living in a really great one that was really well developed outside Ukiah, and co-owning it, I was excited to see this spread to being a more prevailing way people live in the world today, as opposed to it being more of a retreat within this brutal world. And so I've spent many years learning to discover ways that communities could scale up to become a more dominant paradigm. And so I'm here to discuss small group communities, because I love that. And I'm also here to discuss how we can scale it up so that eventually we can render the prevailing system obsolete.
Beautiful. Thank you, Jamie, so much. I love the topic of how can we scale and replicate this and make it more accessible to many people. So thank you for being here.
My pleasure. And I guess to say one thing, I would love an opportunity at some point within this group to dedicate some time to exploring that with y'all.
Yeah. And what we're going to get into is kind of an open space section here when we get through the introductions, and people can propose a topic they want to talk about. And if anybody else is interested, we can create a little breakout room for that. So we'll do that.
Well,
Amma.
Hello, hello. My name is Amma Kimimila Smith, and I am in Boulder, Colorado, currently. I am a nonprofit consultant and business strategist and an artist and someone who really believes in the return of the village. And I was raised, you know, with traditional Indigenous teachings and family, and the village is intact in those ways. And there's a stark difference in common society and family structures and tribal existence. And I'm curious and here and excited to collaborate. And one of the most beautiful things that I've been learning in the space of nonprofit work and just working with different communities and members who are interested in creating something more sustainable environmentally and emotionally, is that as we look around and see which projects are most, like the ones that are flourishing the most, it's because the people have a mindset of collaboration instead of competition. And I'm just so excited to collaborate.
Thank you so much for being here, Amma. And I'm remembering that maybe last time we talked about the potential of opening with you singing a song, and we didn't do that. So maybe next time, or maybe we could end with it. But we had a gathering of the tribes in outside of Boulder and met Amma in June, and she sang a really beautiful song at the beginning of our gathering, and it really started it off in a beautiful way. So thank you, Amma. Robert.
Okay. I've had a long day. I've spent hours moving concrete, mix, drywall, lumber. I've just completed in 3-4 years ago a doubling of the footprint of my house in Vista, California, which is northern San Diego County. And I'm just about to get the building permit approved to add another 1,200 square feet. The lower part is a garage, and it's going to have the half a dozen commercial refrigerator units that I've been using in my food pantry that I've been running for 14 years. Last year, I gave away with two other partners 61,000 pounds of food, and access it through holistic nutrition stores so that there's a variety of really live, fresh stuff. And I was part of an intentional community in the early 70s, and we called it the Ramona Lynn Church. And we bought 16 acres, subdivided it, and had, of those 15 members, our average college studies were 2 years postgraduate. We had 3 PhDs. You know, it was a very intense group of people. And after about 3 to 4 years, having built one building on the property, put in septic, brought in water, all the, you know, we didn't bring in electric ever. We had no intention for that. We all turned 28, hit the Saturn cycle, and then all left. And so a year later, I brought a woman there to be a caretaker, and she's been there for 40 years. And the property's still ready to be developed as an intentional community. Just a matter of finding the right people. And what I've come to realize over the years is that my experience with the human design system is that it's an incredible tool for aligning people that can work together. I've used it in screening people to be renters on the property here and seeing compatibilities and incompatibilities. So it's if you're not familiar with human design, you can go online and print out a picture of your soul and what strategy is best for you to be empowered in life. So I'll leave it at that.
Awesome. Well, thank you for being here, Robert, and doing all the amazing work that you do in the community. And I'd love to chat with you more about that. That land is in Ramona, did you say?
Yes.
Okay. How many acres is it?
16.
16. Okay.
We got four subdivided parcels in it.
Okay. And did you say you called it like the Ramona Church or something?
Ramona Land Church. We called it that so we could say the entire land was sacred and didn't have to pay property tax.
Gotcha. Ramona Land Church. Okay. Yeah. Thank you so much, Robert.
Yeah.
All right. Allison, is that, am I saying that correctly?
Yes, that's me. Sorry, my dog is being insistent that I play with him. We have 20 acres in Bridgeville, owned by our LLC, Gnome Village. We've been here for almost a year. It's off-grid. I have a yurt and a travel trailer and some kids. And we lived in an intentional community in Trinidad for a few years. My youngest was born there. And we named my now 12-year-old Stephen after Stephen Gaskin, because I grew up in Tennessee and we knew about the farm and had read some of his books. And I bought this land last year with my partner, intending to try to create some sort of community with it. And we've been here almost a year and I'm feeling so isolated. You know, I'm about an hour from the closest town. And all my friends in the county mostly live in the North County. So I'm kind of feeling a little desperate. I've been trying to connect with Jamie. And I've been spending too much time on Facebook doing nothing, which is not productive. But I found myself checking into Facebook daily, which I had quit doing for a long time. And I realized it's because I'm lonely. So I'm trying hard to find more homeschool moms in the community to connect with. But meanwhile, winter's coming up again and I've got goats and ducks and I'm thinking, we got to get some more people up here. So anyway, I saw Jamie's post about this group on Facebook and I thought I would check it out.
Awesome. Well, thank you so much for being here.
Yes.
Where did you say that your 20 acres is again?
It's east of Bridgeville off Highway 36. So we're in Humboldt County, NorCal.
Okay.
California.
Bridgeville. Okay. Humboldt. Okay. Well, this is great to know about. I mean, Robert and the 16 acres and you and your 20 acres. And I mean, that's just like meeting so many people like all the time that are looking for places and land and community and stuff. So this is great. So this is gives me things to be like, okay, like you should talk with Allison, you know. I've actually got
Did you want to hear about skill sets at all?
So in our questionnaire, if you want to fill that out, there is a spot to like for skill sets and you can see kind of what other people have done. You might have signed in a little bit late. I can put in the chat again. So a lot of people have filled out this questionnaire about like core values and what they're looking for in community, what skill sets they have. And so you can read through other people's responses and you can also put your own in there. And so I just put that in the chat there.
Okay, thanks.
You're welcome. Welcome, Kelly. We're doing like 1 minute introductions of just our name, where we live, and what inspired us to be here and participate in Gathering of the Tribes tonight. It looks like your audio is still trying to connect. So if it's connected, you can... There you go. Could you hear me when I was talking there, Kelly?
I did not. Just heard it.
Okay. We're just doing a quick 1 minute introduction of our name, where we live, and what has inspired us to be here at Gathering of the Tribes tonight.
Okay. My name is Kelly. I am in Ohio, and I am looking for tribes to share with, to be with, to eventually like to save money and buy some land and grow food and all that kind of stuff. So I'm just trying to get my feet wet. A friend of mine gave me this this site and told me that there's a Zoom meeting, and I apologize for being late, so I'm joining.
Well, welcome.
Thank you.
Joyce, would you like to do a 1 minute introduction?
Sure, and I'm sorry I'm not, let me get off my phone. sorry I am not on camera tonight. Well, I've been tuning in for the last few months, and 2 months in a row, I have attempted to actually get to the physical. Oh, am I on mute?
Nope.
Can you hear me?
We hear you, yep.
Okay, I muted it. Okay. For the last 2 months, I've attempted to get to the live gatherings, and so far, I haven't been able to pull it off. So I'm just determined to get to the one in September. My car isn't great, so I'd love a ride from somebody in LA, and I'd love ideally to have a place to stay Saturday night instead of, you know, traveling almost 3 hours there and back. What brings me here is this just intrinsically feels like a much more natural way to live. I've been wanting to live this way for decades. So far, I've lived as a city person, and you know, I'm just starved for nature. I just want to, you know, look out or walk out my door and have there be green and, you know, the smells of nature and the stars at night and the naturalness of just sharing with people, not sort of going somewhere to spend time with people, but just walking out my door and having privacy and space if I want that, but walking out my door and just interacting and mingling with people I'm happy to see who share my values, who where we support each other's ways of life. We create ways of generating income together, and it's intergenerational. And that's what brings me here.
Awesome. Well, welcome, Joyce. Thank you for being here.
Thank you.
And Michael, we're doing short little 1 minute introductions of name, where we live, and what has us feeling inspired to be here this evening, if you'd like to share.
Hey, Joshua, sorry for late arrival. No problem. I was producing events in Altadena, California, when I was still in Encino. And that's where I know Joyce from. She was attending some of my events over there at a 48 acre ranch that I was working with beginning in December of 2020, but that I had visited in 2007 or 2008, legendary space. And I've been working with a variety of different places, including Bob Broska's a little bit. I was ranch manager of a 25 acre place in Escondido, which is how I met Steve Farmer. He and I were building construction on a property. So it's an honor to have touched base with several of you in this crazy journey of realizing that we've all been thrust into this grid system, this city system that's not actually natural to us, and is ultimately seems to be designed to kill us. So many of us have been looking for exactly what Joshua's been putting together, God bless you, a community that is oriented toward finding farms and ranches, oh my, and bringing us back to nature. So I'm honored by introduction, thanks to Bob Broska, to what you're doing, Joshua, and delighted to be of service in ways that we've just barely begun to discuss. So thank you.
Awesome. Welcome. Thanks for being here, Michael. So we're going to get into our kind of open space here soon. So let's do it.
I'm in a Zoom meeting.
We want to do a real quick introduction. Thrive Lemon Grove. I'm not sure what your name is, but if you want to do just a quick your name, where you're zooming in from, and maybe like 30 seconds of what has you feeling inspired to be here tonight.
Hi, my name is John, and I live in Lemon Grove here, and I had the pleasure of joining your meeting at Stefan's house earlier and recently, and I really enjoyed that, even though I got there late. And I'm very much into sustainability and regenerative agriculture. I helped start the Lemon Grove Community Garden here. And I've known Bob Roska since college for many years. Hi, Bob. Mm-hmm. I haven't seen you in a while, Bob. I've kind of devoted my life to the future of the planet and whatever we can do to save it, you know. And I'm working on, I'm going to have a permaculture garden in my backyard. I'm first building an ADU, and then I'm going to do a whole garden growing food thing. And I'm very interested in wild plants, and I've cataloged all the wild edible plants here in Lemon Grove. I'm working on a catalog for it with a PowerPoint presentation I hope to present to the community so people can learn how to forage. And when times become, when we hit dire straits, you know how to eat from the land. I'm very much interested in that. And using herbs for medicine and healing. Plants are very powerful things, I think. So.
Well, welcome, John. Thanks so much for being here. I definitely recognize you from our in-person gathering.
Yeah, thanks. I'm sorry. I kind of forgot about this today, but I'm
all right.
Glad I can join you now.
That's all right. Lance, would you like to do a quick intro and then we can get into our open space session?
Yeah. Hey, how's it going, everybody? My name's Lance. I'm from the central New Jersey area, right in between New York and Philly. And I remember following Local Earth a while ago on Instagram. And when I saw that the gathering was happening, I was very much open to find very like-minded people about having like some sustainability and agriculture. And I work in the medical field. I'm a tester for a laboratory. And, I'm interested in some alternative theories about medication and not really being into the whole idea of pharmaceuticals, prescriptions, just trying to find alternative ways of healing. I was talking about that at the last gathering a month ago. And yeah, just want to look for very like-minded people and try to get out of the rat race of being so close to two major metropolitan cities, Mm-hmm. And yeah, that's pretty much me.
All right. Well, welcome. Thanks for being here, Lance.
Thank you.
All right. So what we're going to do right now is we're going to do something kind of called open space, which is where anybody can propose. I'll drop it in the chat. Everyone is welcome to propose an idea or a topic for breakout rooms focused on creating healthy, thriving community. You can either speak it out loud right now and take off mute, or you can type it in the chat. And as long as there's at least one other person in the group that's like, oh, I'd be interested in talking about that, I'll create a breakout room for it. And here in the main room, I'll stay here and I will host a discussion around building trust with people, because it's a pretty big decision of, investing into land together or really initiating a big project. And so just discussing how we build trust with, some of us know each other and have history and some of us are brand new. So the concept of going from like a brand new person you met potentially virtually to like potentially investing into land together is a big step. And so I'm going to talk about building trust, and that, that could be just even how to strengthen relationships in the communities that we live in. It doesn't necessarily need to be like people investing into land together, but that's what I'm going to talk about, is just how we build trust with new people. And so right now, it looks like John Paul has proposed economics and software. And do you want to expand on that a little bit, John Paul, of like if you're saying those are like two things together, two different topics, or what you're meaning by that?
So I think like for us to really have thriving tribal villages, we need really good communication tools. And so I wanted to talk about that. And then open source data, like how we can for example, Josh, you're creating a list of all of these different communities, and I did a quick search for a couple of them and I couldn't find much data for that. So creating these open source data networks for us to trade or give away, you know, share information, you know. And then also talking about like the economics of setting up communities. Like I've talked to a few people about like using LLC model and having shares in trade. So like just discussing the economics and, you know, software, how we could utilize software and maybe in a nonprofit way or something like that.
Okay. So like those two, they could be together. So like, I mean, they're a little bit different topics, but if you are kind of proposing them, that you would be hosting that breakout room. And so if anybody else, like you can raise your hand, type in the chat, like, yes, I'd be interested in that. And as long as somebody is interested in that, I can create that breakout room. And the other thing, so we're going to be in the breakout rooms for about 25 minutes. And another thing with open space is you don't need to stay there the whole time. Like if you, maybe you're there for 5 minutes, you know, you get what you need out of that conversation and you can select your own breakout rooms and go to another breakout room.
Sounds like Ahmed's topic is kind of like running into mine. So I'm open to just joining in on that one.
Whose did you say is?
Ahma.
Intentional community and education hosting as a nonprofit versus a land trust versus land ownership. Okay, so like economics and forms of like land ownership stewardship, I prefer.
I like the education part. Like I think that's part of the software is education. You know, you gotta tie that.
Okay. Education, entities for land stewardship, education.
Yeah, Jacques had mentioned knowing a little bit about land trust or not, but I'm curious to learn. And I have experience with nonprofit and with education, but not with land trust. So it'd be wonderful to talk about that if there's space for it.
Okay. So yeah, feels like that could be definitely a topic like that. It could be a breakout. Like, I mean, land trusts are like the entity for how a group holds land. It seems like there's already a couple people who have expressed interest in that. So that will be a breakout room. Stuff I neglected to say, that's okay. Joyce is saying a healing center. Is there anybody else that would be interested in discussion around healing center? If so, you can... So Jacques, yes. Then I just need to make sure somebody's the host for the land steward, like the land entity. So maybe I'll make Ama the host for that, and then Jacques, you could go back and forth between those if you wanted to. And it looks like Jeannie's interested in that as well. Okay, so we've got. Land entity for land, healing center. I'm doing one on building trusts with one another. All right. So unless there's any other proposals, I will create the breakout rooms. I'll add a room right here. Rename that to...
You have a question.
Yes.
I wonder if we can combine the healing center and the land ownership, or is that too complicated?
Two pretty distinguished topics. Right. I think we'll keep them separate for right now. And like I said, people can go, like if you can spend 5 minutes in one room, and if you want to go to another one, you can just grab your through your whatever, whether you're on your phone or computer, you can grab another breakout room and go to that one.
Okay.
So what we're going to do is we'll have about 20 minutes in the breakout rooms, and then we'll come back here as a group and share any kind of like the wisdom harvest, any like really inspiring items that came out of your breakout room that you feel like is valuable to share with the rest of the group. We'll do that. And then we'll close for the evening. So I will open the rooms here. And if you want to stay here and talk about building trust and relationships, I'll be here in the main room. And then otherwise you can go to one of the other breakout rooms. I'll open them right now. And if for some reason you're having a hard time getting into one of the breakout rooms, you can just tell me and I can send you to one of the rooms. All right, is anybody that's still here wanting to be in another, or are you ready to talk about building trust?
I don't know how to go to those rooms.
Okay, which one would you like to go to?
I'll start with the land trust.
The land trust, okay. I'll send you there. Assigned to...
How can I do it myself in case I want to, because I might switch at some point.
Should just be a button somewhere on your screen that allows you to go to breakout rooms.
Yeah. Okay.
And I sent you a notification. I sent you the link to the land entity for land. So it should be somewhere there in your Zoom app. There you go.
Yes, I see it now.
All right. Anybody else? Otherwise, we're going to start talking about trust. All right. Yeah. So we'll kind of open the space. Like I said, just it's a big step to really think of investing into land or a project with people, and what we think about how we could build that level of trust with one another. So let's kind of open it up to whoever wants to share.
I don't have experience in that particular context, so I'm excited to hear from you guys. I mean, I could assume that there would be this to address and that to address. And to me, ultimately, regardless of the relationship or even the species, I offer first. I offer connection first. And that seems to energetically create a space where if people are open to trusting, then it's easier for them to go there. But that's sort of broad spectrum sentence to say. So I'm just kind of curious to hear more about the context and experiences from within context.
Mm. Thank you for starting us off with that, Carrie. Jamie, I'd be curious, like, considering you have done this,
yes,
have experience, like how you went about building the trust with the people that you were involved in communities with.
Well, I can't say how I went about building it, but I can say my experiences that led to the building of trust. Mm-hmm. A couple of basic things come to mind. And that is that when we first get to know each other, we tend to put our best foot forward. And when we put our best foot forward, that's all well and good. But with most situations of living together, there comes a time when adversity strikes and you might not get somebody's best foot forward. And the building of trust is a part of the experience of going through that and having that have a positive outcome, as opposed to when we're putting our best foot forward, everything is fine, and then otherwise we run into all kinds of trouble. So circumstances that lead to working together and overcoming adversity are really handy in building trust. My first experience with that was fits in a little bit to what another fellow brought up. I lived in a rural country school that was formed as an intentional community out of the alternative schools movement in Los Angeles when I was a child. And within 6 months of us living on this 106 acres out in Trinity County, the county came in and said, "You can't have a rural school in an old farmhouse." And how we all pulled together for 6 months to make them go, "Well, actually you can." And here's the things you got to do and what we did to do it and make it happen and resolve it. And so, I've worked with others who have had the same conversation, and it's like, how do we do this without burning the ranch house down every year and see how we pull together? Because we don't want to, you know, walk into calamities. But there's that. So that's one contribution I'd give for the moment.
I love that. So when adversity arises, like finding ways to like lead to a positive outcome and build trust with each other. I'm curious how you got to the point where you felt enough trust with the people that you like kind of co-started like those projects with.
May I offer one reflection before we go there?
Yes, please.
Thank you so much. Just to say, one of the things I'm hearing you say, Jamie, is when things are tough, you made it about the collective vision rather than about the individuals or what any one person is or is not doing. And I think that's a very, very strong approach. Just like in interpersonal relationships, learning to not take things personally, you can both be working toward the common vision. That seems like it would be a really powerful tool if everybody were on board to just say, all right, it's hard for everybody, let's create our vision. So please go ahead with Joshua's question.
Thanks for that reflection, Carrie.
Yes, you're right, I agree. It is cumulative. A set of experiences that keep happening when you work together, where people do what they say, leads to further confidence and mutual desire to either say, oh, you know, I can't really do what I said, oops, ahead of time, or to be able to pull it together. And so, yeah, to make that a priority. And in many of these cases, I've had so many experiences where that happens. Like we had at one place, my most recent, well, it was a long time ago, but the place I co-owned, which had 25 detached bedrooms in a big old ranch house, and we farmed 80 acres of bottom land. And when we were getting in the hay harvest, it's a 24-hour-a-day phenomenon. So at 2 o'clock in the morning, someone who's too tired to run the tractor knocks on the door and says, "Jamie, can you run the tractor?" And so, yes, in the process of addressing the day-to-day life. And then the other thing about building trust is the exact other extreme, and that is when anybody is having any trouble at all individually, that is just as important.
There's a big nuance there, isn't there, for when to let people be and know that the only way they're going to get through whatever they're going through is in their own space, even if the community needs assistance, you know, there's,
yes,
to me, that's such a beautiful dance though. You know, if everybody's doing their best to know that part of themselves, that generosity within themselves and the willingness to see things for what they are, rather than police their community members, you know,
yeah.
I think there's such a beauty in that.
Agreed.
Thinking of when you just, what you shared there about not policing. So we had in our project, we worked for about 6 months creating our core values together before we all moved on to the property. And I think we did a pretty comprehensive job, but we did find out we had some gray areas, and we had an agreement around substance uses. Like, none of us wanted to be around a lot of like alcohol or drugs. And then we also weren't like, okay, we're not saying this is an ashram where like you could not have a beer if you wanted to with dinner or something. So we tried to find a balance, and we came up with, I think, a pretty great set of agreements where that's supported all of us in the concept of health and well-being. And but we did have a little bit of a gray area around like the concept of like potential like plant medicine ceremony, and like if there was intentional ceremony, like that was a possibility that like we were open to if there was like collective agreement with the group. And we were having an event very early on in our project where one of the community members felt like one of the other members totally broke her trust in one of the agreements, and it was a miscommunication. It wasn't intentional, but it really rocked the boat pretty hard like that. And it actually happened to be the landowner of the property. She called me and was like, you know, I want this person off the land. And it was, you know, using sociocracy and like group decision making, we really wanted to get rid of like the hierarchy of like the owner being the king or the queen that had all the decisions. So we're trying to use sociocracy. And even though we're just kind of playing village, because she really was the landowner and we were not co-owners, I invited her to do her best to like play village with us for those 2 years. And I was like, hey, you know, I'm really hoping that you don't just like say he's kicked off the land, like let's work this process of, you know, together. And we did, and it did build a lot of strength in the community. And I think it made us stronger in the long run, but it did. I mean, it definitely, that broke that trust between those two people. They continue to try to heal that for the next 2 years. But that's, you know, that's just a little bit where, and when, I guess what you said, Carrie, about not having the intention of like policing or like trying to catch each other doing something wrong, but like, you know, upholding values together. And then also what happens when an agreement is broken, like people didn't really like the punitive idea of like, you know, you need to be spanked, you need to sit in the corner, you know, but like, you know, what is the appropriate level of, you know, how do we take responsibility if we've broken an agreement or something like that? And I think that's an interesting question for a group to really come to their own, you know, answers with, and every group would be different, but I think it's a really interesting thing to think about.
Did you have that built into your core values? Same situation, how do we address it once it's happened?
You know, we realized we didn't have that clear enough in our processes of what happens when an agreement is broken. So we had to kind of build the bike while we were riding it at times, like, you know, like create that process. And we did, we ended up coming up with a list of like, we color coded it of like how severe of a, you know, infringement on the agreements it was. Was it like a yellow or a green or a red? Like how severe was it? And what were the potential outcomes from like how serious it was, with, you know, a very serious one being like the potential of being asked to leave the land and the project. But no, we didn't have that beforehand. And I think it's a good thing to have beforehand.
A collaborative decision-making process that you touched on should be functional enough that when that type of thing comes up, it can work through it. And yes, it should be always put out in front of us so that when the difficulty comes, we don't first have to dream up a way of handling it.
Yeah.
And then what is the process for bringing the initial group of people together? I mean, self-inclusion, obviously, but I'm curious to learn about that, because you've got to start with a base of trust for those who have included themselves in, or, you know, even to have the 6 months of discussion about core values.
Yeah, it's a good question. I mean, I'm really in this question myself right now, because what we did, it was, you know, at this point, it was probably 5 years ago now or something. What I did is there was a retreat center east of San Diego that I hosted a 3-day gathering for people that I personally knew that I could see myself living in community with, and saying, you know, let's get together and vision for 3 days, go through a bunch of exercises to connect, clarify our vision, and then see if my invite was to see if 12 people out of that group wanted to come together and actually do this. And we did. We came out with actually 12 people, and then one person dropped off to 11, but like that came out and said, yeah, I want to do this. That property owner, Eva, was there, and she's like, I have the land. I'm willing to like agree to this for 2 years to test it out. And so I knew everybody personally beforehand, but not everybody else knew each other. So a lot of them were new to each other. And so I think that for me, that trust was like, I'd known these people for years and had history. And I think what built trust between the other people was like, we had a weekly meeting, and like, did people show up or not, you know? And like, and people really, they really did. Like they really, you know, showed up and participated. And I think that helped the others build trust with one another. And what I'm realizing right now is I have a lot of people that I know that are interested, but again, to like this question of Jamie and like the scale and the scope of like, you know, do we want to try to have 5 or 10 of us or 15 of us together on a, you know, a small little intentional community, or do we want to do something bigger? I've been fascinated about Dunbar's number and something like a village from like 100 to 200 people. And then there's another guy that works with this organization called Regen Villages. He's a professor, I think, at Stanford and a couple of different universities. James Ulrich, I think, is his name. And they, through their economy of scales, came up with a number. I saw this in a conference that, like, oh, like I want to say it was between like 300 and 400 people, somewhere between 200 and 400 people, where they thought it was efficient, like replication, building enough structures, and like where it made sense. And so I'm really curious at why and when, where you would be like the 250, or why you'd be at Dunbar's number of 150, or, you know, if it's just like the close, smallest amount of like-minded friends you can get of 8 of you together or 8 of us together. But I'm really, yeah, I'm trying to figure out where I would want to go with the next scale of something. And I don't know if I know all the people yet. And so hence these things. And it's like, you know, I feel like I haven't met Jamie in person, but like, I feel like we've actually been connected through these types of things now for, you know, several years or something. And I always appreciate Jamie's like presence and the wisdom that he shares. So it's like, I have started to like, you know, build like some level of rapport and trust with Jamie, even though we haven't met. And there's other people that have been part of these things as well. And I guess like Carrie, I remember, I think we've only met once, but like, I remember very clearly like having a lot of resonance with you and like intuition is like, wow, like I trust this person, like, you know, and obviously we're not like, hey, do you want to buy 20 acres of land together at this point, you know, but like, but you know, for me, it could be getting to that point where like trying to meet with people and be like, yeah, like we want to invest into 50 acres of land together, you know, and like,
yeah.
Yeah.
That's cool. I love the conversation, because my tendency is just to be very intuitive and just go, all right, good, go. And discovering more ways to think about things is super helpful for me. So thank you for, excuse me, for the discussion of it. I love learning different ways to think about it. The next question that I want to ask is kind of really basic. And when we say trust, like, are we all talking about the same thing? What is it that we think trust is?
Yeah.
You know, if we see building trust, there's lots of exercises to do and there's like definitions and all that. But it, to me, it's an awesome question. And I'll give you one other, little scenario. I have a dear friend that she and I just hosted a group down in Costa Rica just to go be out with the whales. And she suggested that we do, that we ask everybody in the group, what is it that they trust? You know, how do they feel like they trust the boat or trust? She wanted to invoke trust. And I asked her about that because it made me feel a little squidgy inside. And I said, so I asked her, so what is trust to you? What does trust feel like to you? And she said, it's warm and fuzzy. It's like a blanket that's wrapped around me when I know I can trust. And yeah. And I said, that's fantastic. I love that feel of it. But for me, somebody coming and saying, so what do you trust? For me, feels like a hard line. And it's just because we each have our history with whatever trust is to us. And so I'm curious to hear from both of you about any part of that.
I'd like to touch on one thing that's probably obvious, but or maybe it's not obvious at all. In terms of scale, I have lived with and worked with groups from 8 people to about 25, and a little bit less of a period of time, a group about half in between. And they were all dandy sizes. Even 25, when we had our Wednesday night meetings, we had learned how each other deals well enough that we could move through decisions we had to make pretty amicably and lovingly with 25 people. But then again, I could see that not happening, and that took time to evolve. But it would seem to me, whatever that number is that you could have units who functioned at whatever optimal number of people, and then they could be collaborating with next units of people who were also some number that worked well for them, and that they could be collaborating together in some other shared ways, but perhaps not as intimately. Any number of large organizations kind of functions like that, roughly speaking. Like, I've never been to Mondragon, but I was just speaking with somebody about them Spain. And, you know, there's various kinds of structures that build upon others. So that's my 2 cents worth on in terms of how big, because I believe the whole world needs to be this way as soon as we can. So thinking of scale, certainly a group functional number, which is much smaller than the whole world, but some way of collaborating with the whole world as well.
The word trust is understood to be believing in something or someone that we don't know. And I've come to find in my utilization of the human design system over the last dozen years that selecting housemates based on the probability that their empowerment of who they are is highly predictable. And there are certain balanced connections that can take place that can be seen visually by a human design chart. So I use their chart as a tool to anticipate how they're going to be expressing once they get empowered in who they really are and not anymore promoting role playing or trying to fulfill other people's expectations of who they're supposed to be or what they're supposed to be. So it's a spiritual journey that the human design system calls for, and it says it takes 7 years to unprogram yourself. So I find it to be such a universal and explicit tool of seeing the picture of a person's soul right in front of you and go, oh, I can connect to that, and I can see where that would be a challenge for me. And knowing that up in the beginning makes it a lot simpler for developing long-term building relationships, not just balancing relationships where my learnings are balanced with your learnings. And so it's a spiritual process of discovery. And it's just one tool that I use amongst a few other tools with meditation, contemplation, and spiritual mind healing, the science of mind, religious science traditions that I've had the background in. So that's my say. I trust you'll understand.
Thank you, Robert.
People sometimes build trust too.
Yes. Yeah. Actually, I wrote up a trust in the last month that is designed to be the overseer of the property that I have with multiple trustees cooperatively working together to make group decisions. So it's a formula that I haven't seen around, but I just created it from spiritual inspiration. So
I'd love to talk with you more about that, maybe one-on-one, Robert.
Yeah.
About that. Mm-hmm. And as everybody just zoomed back in, welcome everybody. I hope the breakout rooms were full of inspiration and thoughtful discussion. So we'll take just maybe 5 minutes now to if you have a highlight that came out of your breakout room that you feel like had a lot of wisdom that you feel like the group would benefit from hearing as a whole, we'll open up that space and let's try to keep it just about a minute each, just be kind of concise, the highlight bullet points, so we can get through it. Anybody that wants to share anything, and we'll try to wrap up around 7:30. And one thing that I'm just gonna looking at the name of the land entity discussion of a lot of talk about land trust, and our breakout room was around building trust and relationships with people, but how connected those are in the concept of if you're gonna go together and invest into a community project land together. I mean, that takes a lot of trust to be, putting your time, energy, money into something, and how that can parallel into a land trust, and you're trusting one another to steward the land together. So I think that's kind of an interesting bridge between the word trust showing up there. So let's open up to anything that any of you want to share from the breakout group that was inspiring.
I'd like to say that the thing that stuck out for me the most was just an aha moment that we're all getting together and realizing that we need to do this together. We can't do this separately anymore. And that's huge. It's huge. And it's just inspiring. So thank you all.
Mm. The time of the lone wolf has passed.
I will say really quickly something that I forgot. And one of the reasons I'd like to move on a bigger piece of land is that I would love to be able to host Vision Quest there. I don't know if any of you are familiar with that, but it's something that I've benefited a lot from it. And I've been going through quite a initiation, I would say. So that's something that I'm hoping to hopefully be able to do.
Beautiful. That sounds beautiful.
Love that.
I could even help with Vision Quests. I'm very acquainted with those. So is Amma.
I was going to say, I've done Vision Quests. It might be a good idea to have liability waivers.
Yeah.
Does Vision Questing have anything to do with ayahuasca?
Not necessarily. I didn't lead it, but I participated in one that I remember, and it was incredible. And I was no mind altering other than the beauty of nature and the consciousness of the people around me.
Those are definitely two different ceremonies, for sure. But you can go on your own vision quest during ayahuasca, absolutely, but it's definitely two different things.
Yeah, I think, you know, Amma might be able to speak to, I know there's lots of different types of vision quests, and I think a lot of it stems from First Nations and Indigenous culture, and I know that probably different tribes have different versions of it, but I don't know if Amma has any, you know, insight you want to share about that.
Well, besides liability waiver jokes, I can definitely say that the standard traditional vision quest comes from, as I was taught, the Lakota teachings. They call it humblecha, which means to cry for your dream. And generally, when a person comes of age, which in teepee days would be, 8, 9, 10, 13, when you're stepping into your role in community, you go out, they say, and you go out into the wilderness and you fast. No food, often no water, and commonly it's done for 4 days or until you have your vision, so that you go into nature, into the wilderness, no technology, no contact with anyone but creator and nature and yourself, and you pray until you have your vision, and then you come back from your vision, and someone should put you up on the hill. It's not a good idea to just go out for 4 days, no food, no water, and kind of wander back with no one to greet you or check on you, right?
Mm-hmm.
And when you come back, generally you have an elder or an interpreter who can discern your dream. And then we feast for 4 days to come back into our bodies and integrate.
Beautiful. Thank you for sharing, Amma. Yeah, I think that could be a really beautiful part of a community, is offering vision quests for people and creating a safe and inspiring space for those.
I will add then, we'll also prepare for about a year to go on the hill as a vision quest. And we from the Lakota as well, I've been trained. We make 405 prioritized, and we put all of our intention in it, and that is an important part of the ceremony as well. It really builds up over the months. It really has shifted my life very deeply in my 20s.
Anybody else have a highlight from the breakout that you'd like to share? I'm curious if you guys got into anything around the land trust, anything specifics I'm curious, like, if anything really came out of that or not.
Yeah, it was really nice to hear from Robert about his ideas in and around having a network of people who own land, who have agreements amongst each other, you know, where you could have a membership and like a, what do you call it? A timeshare, permanent timeshare.
Permanent timeshare, yeah.
You could have your permanent timeshare. You could have time over in this community, and it's all a part of the same network. So for people who are a part of a bigger community and maybe are more transient, there could be a grid to click into depending on where you're being called to at the time. I thought that was really beautiful.
Yeah. There is. So we talked a little bit about it maybe a month or two ago. There's a community in Colorado called Juniper Springs in Peonia. And then there's another community down in Costa Rica, Diamante Luz, I think is the name of it. And those two are they're networked pretty well, and they're working on that concept with, you know, different forms of, and even where John Paul's been talking about technology and software and systems, like, you know, there's different tokens and ways that people are now like networking, so that there's definitely, that's in place, like that's starting, or it's not established, but it's in development right now. There's a lot of people working on concepts for it, like that, where you could be part of a network of villages. And you know, it's interesting, some of them I would say, you know, like the, maybe for example, like the 12 tribes communities that are all around the world, those are very clear. I mean, that's like they have the same way that their communities operate, whether it's in South America or Alaska or the US. So like that network is very, I mean, a 12 tribes community is super well networked. Then there's the other idea of like people that are forming their own, you know, communities. They have their land that they don't know each other, and they're forming ways for those to become more networked, where it wasn't formed from the beginning together to be a network. And that obviously gets more complex. But yeah, it's a beautiful, beautiful concept.
Yeah, like my theory is to use version control for a lot of the data and software and just make everything open source. And then there's just a, you know, peer review process to get stuff written to the repository.
Mm-hmm.
Right. It also allows anybody to look at the history too, because you know, version history, you can see all the changes that were made.
Yeah. All right. Does anybody else have anything that you feel was really inspiring from your breakout that you'd like to share before we close up our time together?
I think just an acknowledgement that, you know, we live in these bodies, and, you know, health is just always an aspect of living. And so having a community that, you know, is aware of that and has skills and resources to support that, both for those of us who are living in the community and, you know, to offer as services and resources for the surrounding community to generate income, that would all be really valuable and important. That's part of, you know, when we talk about freedom, a big part of that is health freedom. So I think it's so important to disengage from the prevailing mentality, which keeps people victims and feeling powerless and, you know, like they don't have any control over their health. So that's what I got out of us sharing tonight.
Beautiful. Thanks for sharing that with us, Joyce.
You're welcome. Thanks for providing the space.
Absolutely. Well, thank you all so much for showing up and sharing your wisdom with one another. And let's just close with another moment of presence with one another. We can get a straight spine, get our feet on the ground, and let's take a couple breaths with one another. Take a big inhale. Exhale, sigh it out. Allowing each of these breaths to bring us back into this present moment of gratitude for hearing this call to connect with nature, with community, with spirit, ourselves. Thank you for showing up with open minds and open hearts to share wisdom and inspiration with one another. Letting all of us know that we're not alone in this journey. That we're finding one another and remembering how to collaborate, work together, and build trust and build community. So just a deep thank you and gratitude and reverence to each of you for showing up here. I appreciate you. Remember, if you want to stay in touch between these meetings, you can, the Telegram group's a good way to stay in touch with people and share information. And I see somebody there in the chat asking like for Joyce's number. So if any of you want to put your contact info there in the chat before we close off, like it's be a good way to connect with each other. Anybody that's interested in potentially the Baja project, feel free to contact me. I also put the website link there in the chat. And we'll just stay here for maybe another moment while people put their contact info in the chat if they want, and then we can.
By the way, I've been to the Baja location. It's really beautiful. There's like, there are beautiful houses there. It's on a private beach pretty much, and great trails, and there's a coral reef there that's like protected, and like it's a beautiful space.
Yeah, it really is. I'm looking forward to being down there and really getting to know the Baja area.
Have fun, brother. It's good to see you.
All right, good to see you. Well, thank you, everyone. Hopefully see you.
Give me another minute to put my website, because it said that the way I wrote it, it's not coming through, and I want to make sure people can get a hold of me. So give me 1 minute. Thank you.
I might be able to help you there too. I can grab help as an inside job. I can drop it in the chat right there.
I had a question, Joshua.
Yes.
You mentioned at the beginning of the meeting, third Thursday of the month, then there's a gathering for, I don't know exactly what it was.
Yeah. Third Thursday of the month, we have what we call the Regenerative Community Development Mastermind. And that is a much more focused deep dive. We have like design challenges between each month, and we have little design teams that we work on things with, and we really get specific on, you know, like for example, the zoning and the building permits and the whole process. So I can put that in the chat there as well. I've got a link for that.
Is it online?
Yeah. It's online. There's the mastermind link. I'll put the Baja link in there one more time. It looks like maybe Allison said that she was interested in that. Right. Does everyone have what they need out of the chat?
One moment. I'm cutting and pasting the last little part.
You're cutting and pasting. All right.
Thank you, everyone. Have a good night.
Thank you.
Namaste.
Thank you, everyone.
See you, Robert.
Thank you. It's been wonderful. Thank you.
Yes. Thank you, too.
All right. You good, Jamie?
I'm good. I appreciate it.
Thanks. All right. Thanks, everyone. Good night.
Good night.